vai usar da palavra o Sr. Professor Dr. José Luís Cardoso, professor do Instituto de Ciências Sociais da Universidade de Lisboa, iniciando um período de perguntas e respostas que será orientado e moderado pelo Sr. Professor Dr. Jorge Braga de Macedo.
Senhores Presidentes dos Conselhos Gerais, Senhores Reitores, Professor Paul Krugman, we all appreciated very much your insightful talk. Professor Silva Lopes said everything that is relevant on this occasion, and therefore my comment will be short and just with the purpose of introducing a first question on the topic of your talk today, economics profession in crisis. The reason to be short is that there are many attendants in this Aula Magna wishing to learn from you the magic formula to solve the present European crisis and waiting for your assessment of the painful austerity we are living in Portugal and how to get rid of it. I will deliberately not ask you about these issues. In one of your recent papers about the ignorance and failure of economists to predict and explain the crisis, your last sentence is quite puzzling. And I quote, "The biggest problem we had as a profession wasn't the failure to keep up with a changing world. It was failure to remember what our fathers learned." I am an economist, you said, and it seems that we need some kind of sociologist to solve our profession's problems. To call for the help of a kind of sociologist proves that the situation is indeed rather serious. But the reference to what our fathers learned also stresses the role of historians, and especially historians of economics, to explain the present situation. Your discomfort with the dark age of macroeconomics, as you call it, based on rational expectations and real business cycles models, is fully endorsed by many of us who believe that Keynesian economic theory provides a sound response to understand the current crisis and has proved that the only way to respond to a recession and to fight unemployment is with expansionary policies. One may explain trade between nations by means of a Ricardian comparative advantage model. One may also refute that approach and explain intra-industry trade and specialization with Marshallian concepts of economies of scale and increasing returns. Or still, one may mix the two approaches together in a new trade theory elegant model and get a Nobel Prize for that achievement. This is a nice continuity in a process of synthesis that makes us believe that we are all Krugmanians now. One of your first articles published in 1979 was on a model of a balance of payments in order to explain currency crisis. The latest entry to your blog, dated 25 of February, so written already in Lisbon, is meant to explain that the difficulties of the Gypsy countries, Greece, Ireland, Portugal, Spain, and Italy, within the euro crisis, are not mainly due to a high level of public social expenditure or to a big budget deficit, but rather to the excessive current account deficit of the balance of payments. So again, this is a nice continuity with your article 1979 in order to explain the inner motives of a recession. My point is therefore about continuity, about history in a certain sense, and also about the theoretical cycles that may explain why some theories and policy recommendations are sometimes more adequate than others. My question is thus the following. Since practical men are usually the slaves of some defunct economist, shouldn't we be cautious about the irrelevance of theoretical approaches and policy recommendations we now blame as responsible for the current crisis? What is the place in the conscience of a liberal, in the conscience of a Keynesian, for the awareness of the missing parts of the Keynesian story, or the warnings we have received on the misconduct of governments in the economic front? So this is my question.